Please rise for our invocation. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. We worship in celebration of Christ's resurrection in the name of the Father,
who raised Jesus from the dead,
in the name of the Son,
who died and rose for us,
and in the name of the Holy Spirit,
who has revealed this to us.
Amen. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Our psalm this morning is Psalm 67. May God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face to shine upon us, that your way may be known on earth, your saving power among all nations.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you.
Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon earth.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you.
The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, shall bless us.
God shall bless us. Let all the ends of the earth fear him.
Please remain standing for our hymn. We continue with our confession, even while we sing the Alleluias, even as we ring out our Savior's praise, we realize that we're not worthy to sing his praise. We're not worthy until he makes us worthy, and so we bring our lives as broken, as mistake-ridden, and as sin-filled as they are to him, because he promises to receive them, to change them, and to give us his life. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins to God our Father, most merciful God. We confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us,
so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of the Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. You may be seated for our hymn.
Reading this morning comes from John 5, chapter 5, verses 1 through 9. Will you please rise for the reading of the gospel? Starting at verse 1, after this there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is in Jerusalem by the sheep gate a pool in Aramaic called Bethesda, which has five roof colonnades. In these lay a multitude of invalids, blind, lame, and paralyzed. One man was there who had been an invalid for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had already been there a long time, he said to him, "Do you want to be healed?" The sick man answered him, "Sir, I have no one to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up, and while I'm going, another steps down before me." Jesus said to him, "Get up, take up your bed and walk." And at once the man was healed, and he took up his bed and walked. Here ends the reading of the gospel. Please remain standing for the prayer offering.
Get up, take up your bed and walk, Jesus says. And he heals the man. "Your sins are forgiven," he says to you, and he heals you and he heals me. "Come home to your Father," he says, "and we have a place with God who created all things. We have a place at home with him at his table." It's in response to these gifts. It's in response to all that Christ has done for us. It's in response to, yes, even the miracles that he works in our own lives, that we bring him gifts, that we bring him offerings, that we bring him our lives, we bring him our thanks and our praise, and we pray as we bring those gifts to him. Because this is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. If anyone has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need, but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth. Jesus, you've given many gifts to us. You gave your very life, and by this we know your love. In response, we bring our gifts to you. We bring our very lives. Please teach us to love like you. Our worship and prayers express love in words and speech. May our lives reveal love in actions and truth. Amen. We confess our faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated for our song. Our reading from Acts is also the basis for the message, so I saved it for this part of the service. From Acts chapter 16, beginning at verse 6, it says this, "And when they went through the region of Phrygia and Galatia, having been forbidden by the Holy Spirit to speak the word in Asia, and when they had come up to Mysia, they attempted to go to Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus did not allow them. So passing by Mysia, they went down to Troas, and a vision appeared to Paul in the night. A man of Macedonia was standing there, urging him and saying, 'Come over to Macedonia and help us.' And when Paul had seen the vision, immediately we sought to go on into Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the gospel to them. So setting sail from Troas, we made a direct voyage to Samothrace, and the following day to Neapolis, and from there to Philippi, which is a leading city of the district of Macedonia and a Roman colony. We remained in this city some days, and on the Sabbath day we went outside the gate to the riverside, where we supposed there was a place of prayer, and we sat down and spoke to the women who had come together. One who heard us was a woman named Lydia from the city of Thyatira, a seller of purple goods, who was a worshiper of God. The Lord opened her heart to pay attention to what was said by Paul, and after she was baptized, and her household as well, she urged us, saying, 'If you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come to my house and stay.' And she prevailed upon us." Let me tell you about Cornerstone Church. That's the community I was part of in Texas before coming here. We'd gathered in that setting as a church plant. We had gathered some leaders, and we were moving forward. We had some contact, and we were walking with people who were new to following Jesus, and that was really exciting. There were really good reasons to be excited about what God was doing, and really good reasons to look to the future and anticipate what might come next. Good reasons to keep going. However, we were short on money, and I was working full-time at this job and at this call. So being short on money kind of meant something very personal for me. I bought a house. I had a monthly mortgage payment to make. And so I started looking, and we started looking around for other opportunities which might keep myself and our family present in that place and walking with that group of people. I started knocking on doors, figuratively, and sometimes literally, to see what might open up, to see if there might be some bivocational opportunities, some other work that I might do alongside this work of pastoring. And a lot of possibilities emerged, and I started chasing each one down. And I was knocking on all these doors, and here's what that looked like. I worked as an adjunct professor for Concordia, Texas, in Austin. It was fun. I taught a youth ministry class for students in the Director of Christian Education program. It was a good time. It was a good fit, except that it really didn't pay that well. It was one class, and it was a 45-minute commute one way. So it didn't cover a whole lot of ground. I did a little bit of consulting work, and I looked into maybe doing more of that. I got connected with a church in LaGrange, Texas, and I walked alongside them for a bit in youth ministry and children's ministry and coming up and developing some plans. I was flown up to Minnesota to work with a church there and do a weekend seminar in youth ministry. But while that was a good fit for those churches, and I knew my skills and some of my background was helpful, that was about it. It didn't go very far. I was knocking, but it seemed to be a bit of a closed door. I was asked to work with our local YMCA. They had been given some land, and they were starting a brand new camp. Well, I had a background in camp, and I knew the director of the local branch of our Y, and he connected me with some work there, and I was their challenge course facilitator, working with small groups and bringing people together in conversations and doing activities out at camp and creating different challenges and scavenger hunts and things like that. But it was very part-time, and when you work for a lot of nonprofits and schools, they can only afford to pay so much, so the Y couldn't really afford to pay me very much. And so another door that I knocked on, but it didn't open up real wide. And then I even had an opportunity, which I was surprised at. I'd been serving as a volunteer chaplain with our local fire department. And talking with our fire chief, he wanted to find a way to keep me around. And so he talked with his supervisors, and he got permission to bring me on as a part-time fire chaplain. But the pay was somewhat low, the hours were very limited, and it just wasn't going to fill the gap. I was knocking on a lot of doors. There were a lot of good things that came of that. There were a lot of really good possibilities in the short term, and then a lot of really good things that actually did happen in the short term, but nothing opened up in a way that would keep me there. You see, Cornerstone Church was a house church. We literally met in my living room. If I couldn't afford to live in that neighborhood and I needed to move 30 minutes away, it was like making everyone else commute, and that wasn't going to work. And we realized that. I think my story in some ways has a couple of parallels to what I read from Acts. See, Paul and his companions, they were knocking on doors too. They were taking the good news of Jesus out to people who'd never heard about him before, out to places that didn't know about the resurrection. And they traveled around the Mediterranean, and they ran into some closed doors. And we don't think about that much with Paul, do we? We think about all the good things that happened, but Paul and his companions, they met some closed doors, right? Some things didn't happen. We're not told exactly what it looked like, but somehow the Holy Spirit let them know they were not supposed to travel to the east. We read this. And they went through the region of Phrygia and Galatia, having been forbidden by the Holy Spirit to speak the word in Asia. So we don't know why, but they weren't supposed to go. And after this closed door, the Spirit blocks their way to the north. When they had come up to Mysia, they attempted to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus did not allow them. So they can't go east, they can't go north, right? Both are closed doors. They looked into those possibilities. They tried, they looked that direction, they started traveling, whatever happened, but God made it apparent that's not where they were supposed to be. So passing by Mysia, they went down to Troas. So west was okay. They could travel west to Troas. But while Paul and his companions may have been content to spend their time in Troas, since it's further west than they have ever been, further west than they have carried the gospel up to this point, God has other plans for them. And a vision appeared to Paul in the night. A man of Macedonia was standing there urging him and saying, "Come over to Macedonia and help us." And when Paul had seen the vision, immediately we sought to go on into Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the gospel to them. And that's exactly what they do. Paul and his companions, they go even further west. That's what this looks like on a map. They've gone as far west as they've ever gone. And in this vision, they're called to go further yet. Paul had been knocking on doors. He knew that he had a missional calling. He knew that he had good news to share. And still, there were places that weren't open to him. There were possibilities that were not opportunities for him. That did not negate his calling. That didn't mean he was done sharing the gospel, however. Instead, he tried a new direction. He knocked on other doors. He got turned down this way. He got turned away over here. So he tried a different direction. He tried to share with a different group of people. And eventually, God opened a door for Paul and his companions to go west. And then God called him even further west. Paul received that vision and received that call. Help us. Now, when Paul arrives in Philippi, it becomes clear that there is no synagogue. That was his normal practice, right? Go to the synagogue and start teaching there. But there is no synagogue in Philippi. So while it is called a leading city of the region, it's not a very Jewish city, apparently. It would have taken 10 Jewish men to form a synagogue in a new place. That means there are fewer than 10 practicing Jewish families in Philippi. There's no synagogue where Paul can find a Jewish audience that he kind of is familiar speaking to. It's a very Gentile city. And yet Paul goes there because of the cry, "Help us." And Paul knows that the greatest help that he can offer is salvation by faith in Jesus, who is risen from the dead. And so he goes, and this is what he shares. Well, let me take you back to my story. I tried knocking on a lot of doors. I named a bunch of those. trying this and trying that to see if that would allow us to stay in that place, if that's where we're supposed to be, because there was a calling that my family and I had to share the gospel. And we'd been doing that in that place. But the doors kept closing. And then I received a call from a place to the west. It was a call further west than our family had ever been before. I received a call from God's people in San Lorenzo, California. And in some ways, it was an echo of the man in Paul's dream, that call, help us. From the outside, this place didn't really look like the places that I'd been before. I mean, I'd worked with teams. I'd served in non-traditional settings. This was very much a solo call. It was a fairly traditional setting. And plus, the people gathered were very much a spiritual minority. I mean, within the neighborhood, within the region, being a Christian wasn't on the up and up. Beyond that, kind of a demographic minority, too. We can joke about it a little bit, right? Older and whiter than the neighborhood around us. It's just kind of who we are as Calvary. But this Calvary family, this church family in this place, was knocking on doors. They'd seen some doors close as well. A door closed with the departure of the previous pastor. A door closed with the closing of a school. A door closed as different families kind of moved here and there, and the family got a little smaller. So there are some parallels with Acts, aren't there? The Apostle Paul's story is certainly unique, and yet some of the contours of his story are familiar to us. So maybe Paul's story is more than just a history lesson. It's more than just what happened back then. Maybe it's not just about what happened to him, but maybe this is what happens in some ways again and again as God's people move forward in mission. There's a lot of knocking on doors. There are a lot of doors that don't necessarily open. There's a lot of places we expect to go and things we expect to do that God says, no, you're not going to do that right now. But we keep knocking. And we keep expecting the Spirit of God to be at work. We expect our God is alive. We expect that He desires to see people come to faith, and we expect that He's actually called us to be part of this. So we keep knocking on doors. Here's the next part of Paul's story. And on the Sabbath day, we went outside the gate to the riverside, where we supposed there was a place of prayer, and we sat down and we spoke to the women who had come together. And one who heard us was a woman named Lydia from the city of Thyatira, a seller of purple goods, who was a worshiper of God. The Lord opened her heart to pay attention to what was said by Paul. You know, as I responded to that call to go west, something exciting took place in my story as well. I can still remember it. I was eating breakfast in Santa Cruz, and I got a phone call from the interim pastor. Some of you might know him, a guy named Gary Moore. And he said, what time are you going to be here? And in my mind, I thought, I don't start work for a couple of days. What does he want? And I said, well, I'm in Santa Cruz. I'll be there later today. He said, well, there's somebody who wants to meet this afternoon about a baptism for this Sunday. Can you be here? I said, sure. So we set it up for 1 o'clock, and I made my way up here, and we sat, and there was a mom and dad who wanted to have their baby boy baptized. And as we got into conversation, I didn't know anyone. I'm brand new. So as we got into conversation, we started talking, and I heard dad's story, and then I heard mom's story. I asked mom, I said, have you ever been baptized? And she said, no. And so we looked at the Apostles' Creed, and we walked through some statements of who God is and who Jesus is and all that He's done for us. And I said, do you believe these things? And she said, yes. I said, well, do you want to be baptized? She said, yes. And so we baptized mom and her son that Sunday. Amen. Hallelujah. We baptized, you remember, many of you remember, we baptized Danae and we baptized Jacob. And we're still walking with their family. And I get to meet with their family regularly and still teach them about Jesus. You see, there was finally an open door. There's finally a door that God opened and a possibility that He laid in front of Calvary and in front of me. And like Paul trying to share the gospel in place after place, there were several closed doors first, maybe. It can feel that way, but eventually God pointed Paul to Lydia. He showed him somebody who was open and receptive and ready to listen and ready to receive what God wanted to give. And when Paul baptized Lydia, he baptized her whole household, it says. See, God was at work before I arrived here. God was at work before you noticed what he was doing. God was at work even while we were knocking on doors and some doors remained closed and we thought we were supposed to go here, but that wasn't the direction because God was working over there. And he just had to bring us around to the right place to see it. Now, we ended Paul's story with this. And after she was baptized and her household as well, she urged us saying, "If you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come to my house and stay." And she prevailed upon us. See, that was the start of what God wanted to do in that place, in Philippi. And a new local church, a new family of God's people grew up out of that. And we know this because Paul writes to them later, the letter to the Philippians. And Paul recounts to them the joy that they have in this salvation God has given them. And Paul recounts the joy that he takes, even while he's in prison, from knowing the faith that's been planted in their lives. And so they give and receive this joy to one another, this thankfulness for how God brought them together and how he did his work among them. So what about us? Well, my story and Calvary's story kind of merge at that baptism that I talked about. And that was a little over 3 years ago. And we've had additional baptisms since then. We've had confirmations since then. We celebrated First Communion last week. God is continuing to work. God is continuing to stir some things up. Our God is alive. And we keep knocking on doors. At least that's our calling, right? To knock on doors, to find out what he's doing, to see where he's at work. And let's not forget, we also weathered a pandemic in the last 3 years, so that was a little different too. But more than what's happened in the recent past, I want to call your attention to what will be happening and what could be happening in the near future. See, I said earlier, this story from Acts isn't just a history lesson. It's not about what happened to Paul, but it's an example of the type of thing which takes place when we follow Jesus in mission. See, we knock on a lot of doors. We pray for doors to open. We make ourselves ready for the possibility of discipling, of walking with new believers, of people who are coming to understand who Jesus is. We get ourselves ready, and we eagerly look for opportunities, and we know that some doors are going to remain closed. We know we may be redirected from what we thought was a really good plan. And we expect that the Holy Spirit is at work in people's lives, and that that God's Spirit will bring us into that work when the time is right. And so we knock on doors, we trust God to open the right ones. So as a congregation, I feel like we've been waiting out some things. I feel like I've been waiting out some things, especially through this pandemic, in terms of what we can do and what we should do and what we might do and all that. But here's some ways that I think we'll keep knocking on doors. Here's some ways in which I intend to knock on doors and invite us to take part. See, I want to create some opportunities to invite our neighbors, our family, and our friends into conversation. I want to create opportunities to have fun together. I mean, I've got some ideas stirring for a Lego event for kids and parents. We can invite them here. And I've talked with the Lego store down in Hayward about partnering with us and bringing together the Lego bricks and bringing together some moms and dads and creating a space for conversation to get to know each other. I had a conversation about a crafting event, similarly for kids and adults, and doing something here that we can invite people to. See, we're not looking to create new programs which need to take place over and over again and add more to everyone's schedule, but we are looking to knock on doors and see what opens up in the way of conversation and see what opens up in the way of inviting some friends to meet us. There's room for us to think about other possibilities, book clubs, gatherings around games, food, special guests, presenters, whatever it might be that they would bring, that you would invite friends to, that you would invite family to, that we would get to talk to them. I'd love to see a tea party for girls, with their moms, with their grandmas, and maybe with their stuffed animals too. These are just examples though. These are examples of what it looks like to knock on doors as a community. I mean, these are the kind of events that create opportunities to get to know other people and let them get to know us, to form relationship. They create spaces where we meet people. We knock on doors by opening the conversations. And in my mind, every one of these events, every one of these possibilities also gives us an opportunity to share the gospel. Because if we gather people together for these, we will have a devotion and we'll share who Jesus is and what he's done for us. We will pray with people. We will tell them the joy that we have in Jesus. How could we not? How could we not when he's done all he has for us? He's given us life. That's what we want to share. That's what we desperately want to share. And as you're thinking about all of this, hopefully you can also see implications for yourself as an individual, as a family. See, because you get to knock on doors too. It's not just a pastor thing. It's not just a all of Calvary thing. It's our thing. Jesus invites us to go out with him, meeting people. So you can offer friendship to your neighbors. You can share a meal or a cup of coffee. You can share your time and your attention. And you can offer to share your faith. See, as you're given an opportunity for conversation, I want you to do this. I want you to try asking, how can I pray for you the next couple of days? When you meet a neighbor out in the front yard and you get to talk to them, when you meet somebody at the grocery store you haven't seen in a while, when you call up a family member just to check in, ask that question. How can I pray for you? How can I pray for you and what's going on in your life? If the door opens, because you're knocking, if the door opens, then the Holy Spirit's already at work there, stirring something up, giving you opportunity to be a part of what he's doing. And if it's closed, if it's a closed door, that's okay too. That's okay. Now you know. And now you know that that can shape your prayers. You can pray that God would open that door, would connect that person to your Savior and open them to something as simple as offering a prayer request. So ask your kids or your grandkids who aren't connected to a church home, ask your neighbors, how can I pray for you? It's a great way to knock on the door. And let me stop here with examples, because there's one last thing that I need you to think about. The story that we read earlier from Acts about Paul and his companions and the places that they went, it's not a story that stands by itself. It's a story within a larger context. And we know that, but sometimes we need to step back and be reminded that there's a bigger picture. We need to be reminded that Paul is focused on this mission because of something which took place in his life. Paul is knocking on doors and looking for where the Spirit's at work because Paul's door got knocked on in a big way. We looked at that story a couple of years ago, you remember? He got knocked off his horse, I think. The Spirit knocked on Paul's door and gave him this new life. Jesus appeared to Paul and changed his life. Paul was living apart from Jesus. He was going the opposite direction of where God would have him go. And God called him away from that and turned his life around and gave him a new life. God called out his wrong thinking. Jesus knocked on Paul's door, and Paul was forever changed. See, Paul was saved from himself. He was saved from an eternity of longing, and he was given life and hope and forgiveness and grace and peace and purpose. Now, why do I remind you of the context for this story? Well, because it's the context of your story as well. I'm not inviting you to knock on doors and discover your place and mission because Jesus needs you. That's ludicrous. Jesus needs you about as much as I need a haircut. Okay? Jesus invites you on mission because Jesus loves you. Because he cares so much about you. That's why he invites you. Jesus died for you and he gave his life for you. And that's why he encourages you to knock on doors and find out what he's doing, find out where he's at work so you can be a part of what he's doing. Because he loves to bring God's children home. He wants to share that joy with you. He wants to share that love and that activity even the work that he does. He wants you to be a part of it. His greatest joy is found in bringing salvation to this world. And he wants to share that joy with you. Do you remember the story that Jesus told about shepherd with 100 sheep? And one sheep wanders off, and the shepherd goes and finds that sheep, right? He leaves the 99, he goes and finds the one, and then he comes back, and what does he do? He invites his friends and his neighbors, right? He starts rejoicing, and he invites the people around, and we miss that part sometimes. We don't always notice that part of the story. Luke 15, and when he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbors, saying to them, "Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost." And just so, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Jesus has rescued you. He's given you life in his name. He's forgiven you. You were that one sheep, and he went and he found you. And that is your place in the story. You're the lost sheep who was found, and he celebrates over you. Now that you've been found, you're in another place in the story. You're the friends and the neighbors. You're invited to rejoice. You're invited to celebrate. You're invited to take joy in the finding of sheep, because Jesus is still finding sheep. And he invites you to rejoice with him and to be a part of this joy. Our God loves rescuing sheep. He celebrates it. And he wants you to be a part of that celebration. This is why we keep knocking on doors. We're looking for the next party. We're not trying to do some work for Jesus. We're trying to find out the work that he's doing so we can be a part of it, just so we can be near it. We're looking for the Holy Spirit at work, and we're anticipating the call of Jesus. Rejoice with me, for I found my sheep who was lost. In Psalm 51, a great psalm of repentance, David teaches us to pray, "Create in me a clean heart." And a couple of lines later, "Restore to me the joy of your salvation." Our God takes joy in salvation. Indeed, Lord, restore to us the joy of your salvation. Amen.
Peace like a river, wash over me. Immerse me in water as deep as the sea. Hide me in love, healing embrace. Peace like a river, wash over me as I worship your majesty. I worship your holy name, Jesus, my everything. All that I am is yours. Come, Holy Spirit, rain down on me. Break open the heavens, drench the unseen. Pour out your presence, so pour out your praise. Come, Holy Spirit. Your majesty, I worship your holy name, Jesus, my everything. All that I am is yours. guard the gates, flood every heart with mercy. Pour out your presence, habit all praise, as we cry, holy, holy. Open the heavens, fling wide the gates, flood every heart with mercy. Pour out your presence, and habit all praise, as we cry, cover this land like you've done it before. Would you do it again? Lord, send revival. Lord, send it now. Move with your spirit. Heaven break out. Come now in power. Cover this land like you've done it before. Would you do it again? Lord, send revival. Lord, send it now. Heaven break out, come now in power, and cover this land like you've done it before. Would you do it again? Oh, oh, as we cry, holy, holy. Oh, oh, as we cry.
Lord, send revival. Send a stirring in our hearts, in the hearts of our neighbors, our friends, the people that you love. I know many of the faces, if not all the faces here today, so I know things are very familiar, but something that's a little less familiar is the back page of your bulletin, because it's got a tear-off sheet, and that's something new and different. On the back it says, how can we connect? And so if there's anything there that is helpful for you or that you have questions about, please let me know. Put down your name. Let me know how I can get in touch with you. Let me know what kind of things you have questions about or we can talk about in terms of next steps here at Calvary. Use the space on the bottom, and no matter where you're at, no matter whether you have questions about those things or not, there's space on the bottom and space on the back of that little tear off to leave a prayer request. You can fill those out, and you can leave them in the offering boxes, which are located in the very short hallways between here and the entryway of the church. You drop them off there, and what happens with the prayer requests is they will be shared via email with our prayer team. We've got about 90 people on our prayer email list, some members, some former members, some friends of Calvary, folks who just want to pray for the prayer requests that come up. If you have a confidential prayer request and you mark it as such, then it'll go to me and I'll share that with our elders. And that's the only group that will see that. So please let us know how we can pray for you during the week, even as we turn to prayer now in our worship service. Because I'd also love to hear how we can pray for one another and how can we lift up prayers in this service. A couple of things that are already on the list. We have a prayer quilt up here for a friend of Audrey Oanesian's. This is for Norma. For Norma. Yaglegian. Okay. So I'm going to say Norma in the prayer, and we're going to know that it's not Norma here with us, but Norma Y. We give praise and thanksgiving. Norma's turning 100 on May 30th. And so Audrey was telling me just how active she is as well and all the different things that she still involves herself in. So we want to pray God's continued blessing on Norma. A couple other things we want to pray. If you hadn't heard, last week the voters' assembly here at Calvary approved moving forward with remodeling in the sanctuary here and updating some things and caring for this facility, which is going to involve both a lot of work in here and also a little bit of fundraising as well. So I want to pray God's blessing, because honestly, since the voters' meeting, my mind's been racing, and I've realized there are about 100 different ways we could really screw this up, and every one of them starts with believing we know what we're doing. So maybe it's just a little prayer for humility before God, and that we would submit ourselves to His direction and His leading in all of this. We want to continue to pray for the for peace, especially with the war raging in Ukraine, that God would intervene, that He would lead us and our leaders through this. And I have a prayer request for Dave and Cindy Schultz. Cindy, some of you may have heard, she was back in the hospital briefly this week. She is at home, but she is still testing positive for COVID. So Dave said he's going to stay home as well with her this morning. Dave has recovered from COVID. Cindy, she's mostly recovered from that, but still testing positive. So they're kind of waiting that out. We want to lift them up. Just a lot of challenges for Cindy lately physically. Pray that God would care for them. Other prayer requests that you have this morning. Come over here. Would you please stand for prayer? Father in heaven, we come to you because you've called us, because you've called us to yourself, because you've invited us to speak our minds and our hearts, and you've invited us to receive from you. We admit far too often we think we're going to receive everything we want, but you intend that we would receive what's better than we want. You intend that we would receive all that we need. And so shape our hearts and our lives to receive what you would provide. To receive your grace, to receive your forgiveness, to receive your calling as your people, to receive an identity as your children. And let us be content with that and with all the blessings that come with it. As we move forward in this calling that you've given us, as we seek out where your Spirit is at work in our world, may we have eyes to see, may we have ears to hear, and may we listen well as we even ask our neighbors, our friends, our family, how can I pray for you? May we have ears to hear, and may we hear what you're doing, how you're at work. May we see the doors that you're opening as we knock. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we have many prayers of thanks this morning, and we start off by praying thanks for the long life that you've given to Norma, for 100 years coming up later this month. We thank you for caring for her, for granting her long life, for blessing her with health and wellness. We pray that she would rejoice each and every day in the life that you've given her. And so we lift up Norma. We also pray thanks, Lord, for Mark and Esther on their 60th anniversary. We pray thanks for Ashley, who celebrated a birthday. We give thanks that Kent will not need surgery. We give thanks for Jennifer and Daniel moving into a first home. We honor you and give you thanks, Lord, for Kevin and Mary being well, for answering our prayers and allowing them to be with us in worship. We give you thanks for answered prayers on behalf of Karen, who's been back to work. And we give you thanks for Norma, who is here with us this morning. Lord, we thank and praise you for your answered prayers, for your blessings on these individuals and your blessings on us. And we pray that your blessing would continue, that your grace would continue to flow and to change us as your people. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we lift up this community here at Calvary, and we pray that as we move forward with the remodeling of this space, of this sanctuary, as we move forward with raising funds to cover some of the costs, we pray, Lord, that you would guide, that you would lead, and that you would direct, and that we would be humble enough to listen well and to follow. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for the war in Ukraine, that you would intercede and that you would bring peace, that you would guide our leaders, that you would guide us as your people, that your love and grace, that your presence and your power would be known. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we lift up Dave and Cindy, who are at home this morning. We pray that you would bring healing to Cindy, that you would allow them to rejoin this Calvary family, that you would grant strength, that you would grant comfort, that you would grant peace, Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for Mary as she adjusts to a new life in a care facility. We pray that you would grant her comfort and that she would know your presence, Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for Isaiah. We give you thanks for his completion of eighth grade and for how well he's doing. We pray that as he transitions to high school, that you would care for him, that you would open doors in his life, that you would surround him with your presence and that he would know your grace and your love, Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for Tom Succi, that you would care for him as he's having issues with his leg. We pray that you would grant healing, grant strength, grant him faith, Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for our brother Frank, that all of his pre-operation tests would go well, that all the prep work would go well, and that you would open doors even as he interacts with hospital staff and nurses and others, that you would open doors for him to share the faith you've given him, to share your love and to share your grace. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for Jerry and Margie, that you would watch over them, that you would care for them as they travel, and that you would give them joy in this time away. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we lift up Zachary, who's waiting for a kidney, that we pray that you would provide for him each and every day, in small ways and in big ways, that he would know your gifts and your grace. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for Paul and Lori, for their marriage. It's a gift from you. And marriage is a beautiful picture of the love you have for us. May your love indeed be at the center of their marriage. And may your life shape their life together. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for Ron and for Joyce. We pray for Ron's health. We pray for Joyce as she walks with her husband. We pray that you would care for them both, provide for them both, Lord, in your mercy. Father, we lift up Lisa's neighbor's niece who was in an accident, and her neighbors asked for prayer. And so we come to you and we pray on behalf of this young girl that you would care for her and that you would provide for her, Lord, in your mercy. Father, watch over Erica in the final weeks of her pregnancy. Keep her safe. Keep her healthy. Care for the child inside of her. May this new life be a blessing to her and to her family and to your world, to your mission, Lord, in your mercy. And Father, in the wake of shootings, we pray for your peace. We pray for your comfort. We pray for your protection. We pray for those affected by the shooting, the church in Laguna Seca. We pray for those affected by the Buffalo shooting. We pray for those who've been present to witness and be affected by violence of any sort. And we pray, Lord, that your power and your justice would be known, that your love and your grace would reign, and that we'd find comfort in you, Lord, in your mercy. We lift up all these prayers, Lord, and we pray together in the words your Son has taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ
and
the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And with you.
Amen. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. You may be seated for our final hymn. Couple things to mention. One, I mentioned earlier, last week the voters did decide to move ahead with sanctuary improvements. So a couple of things that are happening behind the scenes and that you will see more publicly very soon, kind of what that means. We've got two teams, if you will, that are forming or have formed, a design team and a fundraising team, because the proposal that was approved includes both the remodel as well as some fundraising for that effort. So the design team will, over the next couple of weeks, be bringing forward some proposals or some things for feedback, colors, textures, flooring, pew cushions, things like that. So watch for that. On Sunday mornings, you'll be able to see some of that and give some feedback to what they're bringing about. The fundraising team is also working on how best to communicate some things, how to present some pieces. So anticipate that that's coming up. Please keep your brothers and sisters at Calvary who are working on both aspects of that in your prayer, and keep this project in prayer as you move forward. The other thing I want to mention this morning, in the entry on your way in, you may have noticed there's a display there. Summer meals for students is something new that our local San Lorenzo food pantry is providing. There are meals available through some of the schools and through the library through the end of June, but then the meal program transitions and some of that goes away. And so the food pantry is trying to meet the need over the summer until school begins again, and seeking to provide, I think the total is 1,000 meals over the months of July and part of August. And so I've been talking with Janelle Morimoto, our food pantry director, and I said a couple of weeks ago, what is something that Calvary could help with? And she said, this is brand new. She's got some partners. And so you can check out the display. You can see the types of things they intend to provide. What we are doing as a congregation is collecting funds for that. And then we will go and shop for the items. As she gave me the list, I realized I could send you each shopping, but actually we can buy it cheaper if we send one person to Sam's and one other store and tell them we need, 47 cases of SpaghettiOs and give us your best price. So we can buy a lot more and we can make sure we get the right items that they need as they put together something that kids will eat, that they can prepare on their own without mom or dad present potentially, and that's relatively healthy, so it has some balance to it. So check out the display. There are some envelopes you can take home there as kind of a reminder to think about what kind of support you might be able to lend to that, and you can bring back those envelopes and leave them with your offering on future Sundays. Are there any other announcements this morning? Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
She has assisted living. She still goes, she's a watercolor artist.
Oh,
and
she
still paints her own note cards.
Yeah.
She decorates, she arranges all the flowers for the facility that she's at.
Wow.
She is, it just renewed her secretary of the residence council.
Wow.
She goes to the movies. She plays Scrabble.
Amazing.
She's something else. She is. She'll be 100 on the 30th.
Oh, wow.
So I wanted to get this to her.
Well, God's been good to her.
Oh, yeah. She belongs to the Armenian Apostolic Church, which is kind of like the Greek Orthodox.
Yeah, yeah.